In the last tutorial, we created a small generative patch, and in this video, I want to take this concept even further and make it more advanced. If you want to save some money on Bitwig Studio and the upgrade plans, and you want to support my channel and my content, then go to my webpage, use the link to the Bitwig store, use my code and save 10% on the regular price. Okay, so this is how the patch looks and sounds from the last tutorial. And we have pitch informations here generated by the pitches module, then modulated the transpose function to get some kind of different notes out of it. And we have a pitch quantize, which then narrows all the pitches down to certain keys on the keyboard. And in this case here, it's the scale of D sharp minor pentatonic, I think. No, it's D sharp minor. And then we have a sine oscillator producing some waveforms, and we have an volume envelope or an ADSR envelope that triggers is triggered by the skates module. And the skates module is synchronized to our transport here, where we have here the phase input coming from our transport. And then we have a small little bend module here to get some kind of swing, where we basically influence the phase signal a little bit, disrupt the phase signal a little bit to get some kind of groove. Okay, so now we want to take a closer look at some of the signals, because we need to learn something, how we can influence these signals to make this patch more advanced. Okay, so I lower the volume a little bit. So let's bring in some oscilloscopes so we can look at the signals and how they behave. So maybe switch this here to slow. Okay, so this is the gate signal. Then we have down here the pitches signal. And then we have, of course, our output here, which is an audio signal. And then we have here in front our phase signal. Okay. So you can see the phase signal here basically is a small little ramp, and we influence the ramp here by the band, so bring this back to zero. So the phase signal is a ramp going up from zero, value zero, to plus one, okay? And this signal is basically used in most cases to synchronize certain modules to the speed of your project. In this case, it's 172 BPM here. And you can see this signal goes straight into the gates module. And the gates module tries to cramp all these steps, which in this case are three steps. So the gates module tries to play these three steps in between where the signal is at zero and the signal is at plus one. So it uses this kind of ramp as a synchronization option. So when we don't change the phase signal here, but we increase the step count on the skates module here from 3 to maybe 16, you can see the gates are played much faster now, because now it tries to play 16 steps in between 0 and plus 1, right? So we can increase the step count here, but the gates module tries to complete the whole sequence here, where the signal ramps up from 0 to plus 1. Okay, so this means if you reverse the signal here, going from top to bottom, then this should play basically backwards or in reverse, right? So we try this now, and we use here phase reverse. Okay, so we put this here in between the band. So you can see the signal is now reversed and the gates module plays backwards. If you remove this, it goes forward again. So this is a synchronization signal, basically. So when you change the signal, you also influence the playback behavior of some of the modules. So when you bend this here, you can see it starts slowly and then it plays much faster in the end, right? Or vice versa, so you play fast and then it becomes slow at the end. so you can influence some of the playback behavior of some of the modules. So this is nice to know. And also the signal is unipolar between because it's between 0 and +1. There are no negative values. So then we have this gates signal, gates module, which outputs gate signals. And maybe go back here to the step size of 3, so it's better to see what's happening. And this signal is also unipolar because it's between 0 and +1. And also there are no in-between values. There's only values of 0 and 1. So it's a binary signal, basically. There are only on and off states. Unlike the phase module here, where we have a lot of values in between 0 and 1, the gate signal only has values of 0 and 1. It's a binary signal. And then you have here down below the pitches signal, of course. You can see it's a bipolar signal because we have some values here go into the negative range. So in terms, in the case of the pitches signal, the middle line, the 0, is basically the middle key of our keyboard, which is in most cases C3. Okay, so we can go downwards in on the keyboard below C3 and go up the keyboard, of course. So, and this results in the signal, as you can see here on the oscilloscope. We have different pitches here happening, and this goes straight into the sine oscillator, and the sine pitch input here plays the key, or the frequency of the input key accordingly, right? And then we have here at the end, the output is an audio signal. It's also a bipolar signal. It goes from +1 to -1, also in the negative range. And also a difference here is that all these values are changing very, very fast at audio rate. And it's called audio rate because you can use the signal and hook it up to a speaker, and then you can hear something. Of course, you can use also here the gates signal and hook it up to a speaker, but you don't hear anything besides maybe some small little clicks, because the speaker cone moves in and out pretty much between the two states, maximum and the zero line. And yeah, you maybe hear some clicks, but besides that, you can't hear anything. Also, the pitches signal here, it's a pretty slow changing signal. And also, it's not, the values are not very high. So you need pretty much a lot of values changing over time to get the speaker play something you can hear. But inside the grid, you can exchange all these different signals with each other. So you can use the gate signal for pitch input, for instance. You can hear now the sine oscillator plays a C3 note, and then it switches instantly to the highest note, because we are switching between 0 and +1. The highest note is maybe C7 or C8 or something like this, and you can hear it barely. Pretty high-pitched tone in between. So it's not very useful, but you can use it if you want. Maybe in some patches you need exactly that. Then you can maybe also use the phase signal as a pitch input, right? So this should behave, or maybe you can guess how it sounds. We switch between C3 and then we go slowly up in pitch, and it sounds like a riser. Also not very beautiful, but maybe you need something like this. Then we can use maybe the pitch output here as a gate input. So we want to trigger the ADSR, but nothing happens, right? And this is because of the nature of the gate signal. The gate signal is, like I said, a signal between 0 and +1. And only the gate input jack here recognizes something as a trigger when there's a certain value exceeded, basically. And I think inside the grid it's 0.5. So as you can see, the pitch signal here behaves around the zero line, and we are never reaching basically here the 0.5 line. So there's no trigger happening, right? So what we need is we need to have some kind of threshold where we lower the threshold value, basically, or we do the exactly opposite. We amplify the signal, which we can do by just using a volume knob. Okay, so we have now a volume knob, which is basically intended to amplify an audio signal. But inside the grid, all signals are in the same domain, so you can also amplify pitch signals or all the other signals if you want. So we amplify the signal, and you can see here some of the values are now amplified in both directions. So we get much more dynamic signal. And some of the pitch signals here are now exceeding the 0.5 line. So now the system recognizes these signals as a gate signal, right? And the more you amplify the signal, the more of the pitches exceed the 0.5 line, the more you trigger this ADSR. If you bring it back here, nothing is triggered because all the signal values are basically back to below 0.0.1. Okay. So you can exchange all the signals if you want, but sometimes some of the signals need some work to do exactly what you want them to do, right? But in general, you can exchange all the signals. So maybe remove this here and use the gate signal back to its original state. We have now used here this volume knob to amplify the pitch signal. And because we are doing this, the pitch is not in the scale anymore, right? Because they are all over the place here. Some of the pitch values are now some in between keys or in different scales and so on. And you can fix this by just moving this in front of the pitch quantize here, because the pitch quantize then brings all these random pitch values back to a scale or back to these keys you are selected here, right? So we can amplify this again, and now we get also pretty random pitches, but they are still in the scale of D sharp minor. Okay, so we are using basically the transpose still to change up our initial notes here, right? So we have painted in some initial notes, and then we are just randomly modify these notes, so we get some kind of random notes out of it. But we don't need to do that. We can use everything we want inside the grid to generate signals, right? That's what we learned. So maybe you can use here an LFO, switch it to sine. You can also use all the other shapes, of course. Maybe go to bar, so a pretty slow signal over 4 bars here, and then input this into the pitch quantize. And you can see we have now a sine wave here, and the sine wave is unipolar. It slowly moves from 0 to plus 1, and we know that the pitch signal is a bipolar signal, so we need to switch this LFO signal to a bipolar signal. We can do this by just clicking the small little plus minus icon here. And you can see Now our sine wave goes between minus one and plus one. So we have now a bipolar signal, right? We can also remove this here. We don't need this anymore. But also you can see it now moves between the lowest possible note and the highest possible note, which sounds basically like shit. So what we have to do is we have to limit the range of the LFO, and you can do this by using, for instance, a scalar. We can do this in all kinds of ways. So we have your level scalar, we have a pitch scalar that you can use. You can also use a value scalar. For instance, I just use here the value scalar because it's more meant for using it with audio signals. But inside the grid, it doesn't matter. So now you can say, I want to limit my lower range here, the lowest possible note that's played and the highest possible note that's played, okay? You can see now the signal is not reaching that far from the zero line anymore. So you can, yeah, limit the range basically. So maybe make this a bit faster, yeah, 2 bars. Okay, maybe. So something like this. And now you basically play pitches in just one octave of the keyboard. And if you want to have more higher notes or more lower notes, then you can modulate here the limit of the low and the high end. So now you have more like an algorithmic approach to generating notes, because our algorithm is generating a sine wave, which then results in a melody or in a pitch signal. And you can limit this pitch signal here in both directions, in the negative range and in the positive range, and basically modulate also these two knobs here and change it over time in your patch if you want. And all we have to do now is basically to make the signal here, which is just a boring, simple sine wave, which behaves in results in a melody that goes slowly up and down and up and down, which is a bit boring. So we have to disrupt the signal basically to make it a bit more interesting. Maybe go back to exceed a bit here the range. Okay, so we can use maybe a second LFO, right? And the second LFO depends on what you choose here, can then phase modulate the first LFO, which is our simple and boring sine wave. And you can disrupt this boring simple sine wave with the second LFO playing at a different speed with a different waveform. Maybe you can go here for a triangle and then just use phase modulation to disrupt the signal. You can see here now our simple boring sine wave looks a lot different now. And this results also in a more interesting melody. Okay, so when you choose your different speeds for each of these LFOs, you get more different melodies out of it. Maybe it's more interesting to have some, unique speed settings on all the on all these LFOs here to create more polyrhythms and polyrhythmic behaviors of the melodies. But you can figure this out and can experiment with it. There are no set rules for this, so it's generative, right? You can generate what you want. But this is more like an algorithmic approach where you have some defined rule set for a system, and the system generates some notes and gives you some random notes in the end, right? So this is something you can use to generate notes on the fly. You can also maybe just exchange this here for a random modulator, and which then gives you a lot more different notes in the end, because it's basically randomly changing to random values all the time. And because you're using the LFO or the sine wave here, you still have your bass melody intact. So it's just used for disrupting the simple sine wave melody, which goes up and down, and you bring in some, you basically have some nice flavor on top, basically to disrupt your boring signal. And yeah, you can use this to spice up basically the generative approach or the generative note generation over time. And yeah, this is just one way of doing it. You can of course use also more LFO, so you can modulate this again. Of course, if you want, you don't need to do that, but you can do it. You can also maybe use the phase signal and disrupt it this way, if you don't want to create many modules. You can see it also changes here the melody a bit over time. So this is also a possibility, right? It's also possible that you just modulate here the skew of the LFO, right? You can also play with some of the phase offset options. So there's a lot of possibilities, right, to change this, and the pitch quantizer makes always sure that your pitches are on the right key. So pretty interesting stuff. Okay, so now that we know that we can influence here the pitches signal pretty easily, can apply all kinds of effects here. We can also of course change here the bend, like I said before. We can use here the playback swing speed or ease in and ease out algorithm. Just have some kind of rhythm happening. Can change this also over, or can modulate this here maybe with the LFO. So you get a pretty characteristic phase signal out of it, which then is used to play back here this gates module, and this results in this kind of pattern of gate signals, which is used to trigger the ADSR. Okay, so the phase signal is also interesting here, because we have all these kinds of phase options here. As you can see, we can play it in reverse. Can also use some kind of mirror option here. So you can basically shape the phase signal in all kinds of ways. And these phase modules here are also useful for all the other unipolar signals. So you don't have to use these signals only on phase signals. So you can also use it on a pitch signal if you want. So let's do this actually. So all we know is the phase signal is a unipolar signal and the pitch signal is a bipolar signal, right? It goes in the negative range. So we have to change this a bit. So maybe go back here with the LFO to unipolar signal. So it waves around 0 and plus 1. And then apply here some functions that are initially meant for the phase signal, maybe in reverse. And the value scaler looks like, it looks like the value scaler actually also makes sure that the signal is bipolar, because we have here dialed in some negative range. As you can see, the signal is completely bipolar. So when you use this signal, you can see it's between 0 and plus 1. But when we use the signal with the value scaler, it's bipolar again. If you don't want to use the value scaler to make something bipolar, then you can use, I think it's in the level option here. There's a beta uni and uni to bi. Okay, so you can make uni signals bipolar and vice versa. So for instance, when we remove this here, and we have now a unipolar signal and we want a bipolar signal, then just hook this up in between here. And now we have the value scaled back to the negative range again. You can also use this to make it unipolar again, right? So these two modules are in the level category. So pretty useful. But in this case here, we have the value scaler, and when you dial in here a negative range for the lower limit, then you get also a bipolar signal. Okay, so make this a bit slower. Minus 4. We have a reverse inside, a mirror. And maybe let's use here, let's move this mirror and maybe use a sine mod. So we modulate the signal with the sine wave, which gets you a pretty interesting shape. Maybe make this here a bit slower. 16 or 8. That's okay. So we can shape the signal until it sounds nice. Okay. So also the gates module here, which generates our gates triggering for us, it's pretty okay. I use it all the time, but you don't need to use actually the gates module. You can also use here, of course, in maybe an oscillator, or you can use an LFO. As you can see, when we switch this here to square wave, we get a similar gate signal as before, just with the LFO. And we can use here the phase signal to influence the phase or phase modulator LFO. And you can see we get some interesting shapes here in. Maybe make this a bit slower. So the phase signal now is not a synchronization option anymore. It's more like to disrupt the LFO shape in a certain way. So it has a different purpose now, right? But this kind of works exactly the same. So now that we basically learned how a signal behaves or what a signal exactly does, you can fake it with other instruments or with other modules inside the grid and misuse some of the modules inside the grid to behave in a certain way and to make something that's not intended for. So we use an LFO to trigger the ADSR, and we use an LFO to generate pitches, a sine mod, which is initially meant for a phase signal. Then we reverse something with the phase module, and then we use a value scaler, which is meant to be for an audio signal to limit the range. Then we use a pitch quantize. And so we use a lot of modules that are not used or not meant to be used in this way. And we misuse it to basically create interesting pitch signals. We use it to create interesting gate signals or interesting rhythms to get in the end some kind of interesting output, right? And that's all there is to it. If you know how the signals look and how they behave, you can just fake it and make everything happen inside the grid. And yeah, all these modules here, like the LFO, have also some nice little handles, modulator handles that you can use, and just randomly here apply some of the some modulations all over the place to make stuff more interesting. That's all I do when I basically create these generative patches on my channel. I just throw stuff in there, and then I look which signal can I use to modulate something, and then I try it out. If it sounds good, then I leave it, and when I don't think it's good, then I remove it again. So it's more like an massage of the system and trying to get something nice out of it. And of course you need some kind of experience with sound design and with making tunes and so on to know when something sounds nice and how you want to structure certain sounds. So we have a bass sound and a middle sound and a top layer and so on, and what makes an patch interesting. So but for myself, I'm trying to make all layers as interesting as possible. I try to make a lot of movement. I try to make a lot of modulations all over the place. I try to generate a lot of notes that are in a certain range, stuff like this. So it takes a while until you know exactly what to do. But for this kind of tutorial, I want to show basically that you can use all these modules in combination and misuse some of the modules to create interesting systems. And in a certain way, making generative music, it's a bit harder than making a song or a static song, because it's more indirect, right? You don't actually create the music, you create the system that then creates the music. It's basically a step higher in the hierarchy, where you create a system and the system then creates for you a melody and a song. And you need exactly to know what kind of thing you need to change on your system, so the system behaves in a certain way and it gives you the output you want. So it's, you know, it's a step higher in the brain. Basically, you need to step up in the level or in the hierarchy to get certain outputs. Okay, so I think this tutorial is already pretty long. So I think I continue maybe on this patch again in the next tutorial. Maybe I have some ideas I can show you. But for now, I think I got my point across, what I wanted to say. So thanks for watching this video, and leave a like if you liked the video, if you learned something, and leave a subscription. Ask me questions in the comments. I'm open for everything. Maybe subscribe on Patreon to help me or to support this channel, basically. And yeah, I'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching, and bye.